Hi, I'm DJ. I'm excited to present our journey of navigating graduate school with a disability. Our emerges in this talk are decorated. So what is this talk about? In graduate school, people with disability use disability accommodation such as wheelchair captioning and in-class drive. However, due to the unpredictability of the graduate school, there are many situations in which this pre-planned accommodation do not work. Through a Trio-Ethnographic account of three graduate students with disability, we highlight the complexities of the situation and where our pre-planned accommodation did not work and the use of intuitive alternative coping strategies. Patchwork reports on a few autoethnographies of graduate students, but in the field of education and disability studies. Within computer science, however, researchers have only investigated singular aspects of graduate education, such as the use of specialized accessible technologies and the accessibility of specific classroom courses. Through an autoethnographic approach, we examine longitudinal insights from within, the world in which personal insights rarely available through other research methods in STR. But what is autoethnography? It's a qualitative research method where the researcher adopts the role of a participant and quickly reflects on their experience. We chose this method because disability is highly personal and we wanted the method to amplify our first-person voice as people with disabilities on a computer science research. To be more specific, we use Trio-Ethnography, a form of autoethnography where three researchers engage in a colloquial dialogue. Let me briefly introduce the autoethnography. We are third and fourth year computer science PhD students from the University of Washington. We are also international students from India and Pakistan. I am hard of hearing. Venkatesh is blind and Arthur has limited mobility. We report our experiences from earlier years of grad school. 3 years for me, 2 for Venkatesh and Arthur. To document our experiences, we use a combination of retrospective accounts and intuitive field notes and analyze them using open AGL and selected current. The documentation in the paper is very well, but to fit the time, I will only highlight a few examples within three themes. Our self-image, relationship, and technology shape our disability and the accommodation process. First is self-image. All of us are international students. Because of the cultural shift from the Asia to the US, coupled with the heightened expectation of the graduate school, we are sometimes conflicted in our ability to advocate for our needs and avail accommodation. This leads to tension. For example, elders. I struggle with asking for accommodation out of the fear of appearing good. As a foreign national, there is this continuous pressure of fitting into the American culture, of appearing friendly and getting along with others. Plus, there is this constant stress to prove myself in grad school. All this leads to a constant worry in the meeting. As an example, I was in a STR seminar and was not able to understand much. Instead of asking 10 people to speak slowly and clearly, I would just sat there pretending to do my own thing, trying to pretend. Similarly, Arthur wrote, in an attempt to be normal, I tried to take notes for myself during my meeting. Because of my limited manual dexterity, and my notes are always incomplete. But I didn't ask for help. Writing notes myself is one of the things that make me feel like the other students. It was also because at the beginning of the grad school, I really wanted to have another advisor and want to impress him instead of appearing incompetent. This example shows how graduate school can magnify the fears of disclosure due to increased self-expectation and due to power relationship. This brings us to a second theme, relationship, which further details how complex relationship in graduate school can impact disability and the accommodation process. Let me talk about an example of Venkatesh, the blind author's experience. As part of an event, a few PhD students had decided to hang out at the beach. I wanted to go out there, so I took an Uber to the beach. I was worried about how I would find the group when I get there. The event organizer just sent a picture to the event page saying, "We found this path." Okay, I thought I'll just send the picture to Ira, the visual interpreter service that I use, and have them find the group for me. However, when I got to the beach, I became a little anxious. So I tried to call a friend whose phone number I had, but she didn't answer. So I posted in the event group, "I'm at the entrance. Can somebody help get me?" I got a text back. "Knowing where you are would help." I want to say, I obviously don't know where I am, but didn't want to appear as this helpless person asking for help. So I opened IRA and called the agent. It was an extremely stressful situation because I sent the picture to the IRA agent, and to upload the picture, I was asked to share my Facebook password because the email wasn't working for some reason. Can you imagine sharing password with a random stranger? And on top of that, I was afraid that people might perceive me as a weirdo or pervert taking pictures of people and women. Luckily, I found a few other people who were also looking for the group on the bill. I ended the IRA call there. This example shows how complex relationships can cause issues of privacy and inaccessibility by using the very same technology that was supposed to be instead accommodating a disability. In the third theme, technology, we show another example of how accessible technologies themselves can cause barriers, specifically when people with multiple disabilities interact with each other. Here's an example. Sam had a parent. To accommodate me in the in-person accessibility seminar, we used the talk and pillow approach. There were separated objects such as a talk ball or a pen, and only the person possessing the object was allowed to speak. This made so much difference. The pillow ensured that people speak one at a time, and since the rude left, it gave me a visual indicator of who's speaking. I felt belonged, included, and being able to productively participate. However, all the visual cues that I benefited from were inaccessible to Venkatesh, who was also the part of the seminar hero. While the pillow was really necessary for DJ, it caused some of an aspect barrier for me because I couldn't see it being separated around. He added, however, I eventually got over it because many people missed catching the pillow and became a funny, playful thing where people would laugh if anybody, including me, missed catching. In summary, our experiences show how inaccessibility really occurs in the details by highlighting the social, cultural navigation process and the emotional burden involved. We show that while planning and care can certainly improve access and should be done, not all situations can be accommodated beforehand. So what to do? In our paper, we propose four types of unstarted accommodations, that is ad hoc, intuitive accommodation, proactive customization, effective collaboration, community participation, and repurposing existing technologies for intuitive needs. While I like to discuss them in the interest of time, I encourage you to instead read them in the paper so that we can together make graduate school more inclusive. Thank you.